Right. Next, good evening everyone. In today's class we are going to see semiconductors. So almost all the modern devices that you take, all of them will work with transistors, diodes, amplifiers and logic gates, processors, everything. You name any machine that does some logical aspect of life, mobile phones, radios, TVs, remotes, microwave ovens, almost all the gadgets which does some kind of logical operation with some thought will definitely have one of these equipments, and all those equipments, they are indirectly electronic devices. And almost all the electronic devices will work with help of semiconductors. Okay, so indirectly the purpose of studying semiconductors is we have our electronic devices working with help of semiconductors. Okay, so that much important these semiconductors are in our everyday life. Now if you look at the logical aspect, okay, our solids, if you take our solids, they have definite shape, volume, that is what we are saying. But usually your solids are classified into, for chemistry's sake, you will classify it into crystalline and amorphous solids. Like this you will classify. And you must have studied in chemistry that they have sharp melting points, such kind of properties you will be studying in solids. In general, this is one kind of classification that you have. Now, one more kind of classification that you have is within the solids based on electrical properties. Okay, based on electrical properties, okay, based on electrical properties that you have. Okay, so you have another classification, okay, which is conductors, then followed by insulators, okay, then semiconductors. Okay, actually I should have written semiconductors in the middle, but still no issues. Okay, so based on the electrical conductivity and electrical properties, I can divide my solids. Okay, once again I am classifying solids only. So your solids are into three categories: conductors, insulators and semiconductors. Now your conductors, they are very good in conductivity, okay, and they have low resistivity. Insulators, they have high resistivity and low conductivity. Semiconductors, it will be moderate. Okay, so it's better I'll change it this way. Okay, I'll write first conductors, then followed by semiconductors, then insulators. Okay, so based on electrical properties you are dividing the solids into these categories. Now if you take the resistivity, okay, if you take the resistivity, your resistivity will be, okay, your resistivity will be high. Okay, exact values I will give you, don't worry. It will be moderate. And for insulators it is, okay, sorry, resistivity is low. What am I writing? Low, moderate and high. Your conductivity, if you take, okay, if you talk of conductivity here, your conductivity is high. Okay, for semiconductors it is moderate. Okay, and for insulators it is low. Okay, now how is that I am deciding? We know that from current density chapter, your resistivity rho is 1 by sigma, right, where sigma is conductivity, electrical conductivity, rho is resistivity. So if one is more obvious, other will be high. Okay, so based on electrical properties you are dividing solids into these three categories.
okay. Now what exactly is conductor, what is semiconductor, what is insulator, based on band theory and some other properties we will be differentiating these three, okay. But still let me give some small basic points so that it will help you out, okay. So a semiconductor, indirectly I'll define my semiconductor as, okay, indirectly a device, okay, it is indirectly a device whose conductivity or device, okay, whose conductivity is, device I should not write, I can write material, okay. So material whose conductivity is between, okay, is between metals and, okay, metals and insulators, okay. So what are the metals, let me tell you. Your metals are, I can give the examples for metals as aluminium, okay, it is copper, aluminium, then I can write sodium is also kind of metal, and for insulators I can give example of wood, then diamond, okay. And for semiconductors, what are the examples means, okay, for semiconductors the classic examples that you have are silicon and germanium, but there are other classifications as well, but elemental form silicon and germanium are semiconductors, okay, right. Now once again in semiconductors, okay, once again in semiconductors there is one more classification, but all that is not required, okay. So in elemental form, if you are trying to take this semiconductors in elemental form, in elemental form people will give silicon and germanium as example, all right. Next, in once again in the compound form, okay, compound form in the sense it is combination, okay, it is combination of different elements. So in compound semiconductors you will have organic and inorganic semiconductors as well. So I don't remember the examples, but still just let me have a look into some reference book. So in the organic form, if it is there, no, I don't remember, but there are certain names, okay, as of now I don't remember. In the books if you see, you just have a look, just hold on. Yeah, compound ones, gallium arsenide, GaS, in the inorganic form, and in the organic form polyaniline anthracene, okay, not required, nobody will ask this, okay, why to waste time on this, okay. So these are the basic information about semiconductors, okay, this is just basic information, okay, all right. Now copy this thing down, and if you have any doubts just let me know, okay. Hope there are no doubts, relax, take time. So insulators examples I have given, semiconductors examples I have given, metals I have given, okay. Now your resistivity and conductivity, they are reciprocal to each other, this is what I have explained, okay. Now if you take this semiconductors, why we are actually using semiconductors means, the main advantage of semiconductors is your size, durability factors and flexibility factors will mainly come into picture, okay. So initially when people invented computer in the first starting stages, people used vacuum tubes. Now if you look at the vacuum tubes, okay, Vacuum tubes, what is the main basic logic and idea? You will have some cathode and anode, okay, and you will connect some battery. It will start emitting out some electrons when you actually give some power supply. Okay, now electrons, they will come out of atoms when you give some heat, thermionic emission. When you give some field, then also it will field effect. When you give light, if electrons are coming out of metal surface, probably some sodium tungsten which is having work function lesser value, so that is photoelectric effect. So there are a lot of ways in which you can actually make the electron come out of the metals. But now if you look at the starting stages, why we have invented semiconductors means, in the starting stage when you take vacuum tubes, okay, so you need battery, lot of power supply, space, energy, okay, durability, vacuum creation, okay, this setup will be in vacuum, okay. So lot of factors are there in using vacuum tubes and trying to give current, okay. So to give current I, okay, this much lot of constraints are there in the initial stages, okay. So if you have these issues, okay, if you try to use semiconductor in place of these vacuum tubes, okay, what is the advantage means, your semiconductors, they are, okay, small in size, less energy, okay, because you don't need much energy for semiconductors to start conductivity, okay. So basic simple energy is enough, you just need to send light, that's all, that is enough. Even if you take the solar devices, okay, you will have light emitting diodes, in LEDs, or if you take solar lights, what they will do is, like, they will take from sunlight energy and they will give it out some current, okay. So my point is, you will have in semiconductors less energy, okay, here it is, less durability in vacuum tubes, they are more durable, okay. So lot of everywhere in every aspect of life, what will semiconductors do is, they will reduce the size small, okay. If you take them instead of computer, we are coming to laptops, why, because semiconductors. Instead of laptops, still people have cut short to mobiles, why, once again it is semiconductor devices, okay. Inside you will have lot of semiconducting devices, okay. So here my point is, if you are using vacuum tubes, lot of troubles are there, people have invented semiconductors, now lot of aspects are there, okay. But out of this was the initial stages of invention, but out of the lot of applications, your semiconductors ultimately has, okay, semiconductor advantages that you take in any device is, okay, it is a controlled device, okay, right, it can control the flow of, okay, control flow of charge carriers, okay, charge carriers in the sense, okay, previously you have studied as electrons as the charge carriers, but you will study two things here, electrons and holes. What is electron and what is hole, I will explain, don't worry. And second thing is unidirectional flow, okay, main advantages is this unidirectional flow of current, okay. Your semiconductors in almost any device you take, it will do these things, okay. Like if you take later you will study in this chapter reverse bias and forward bias, okay. Forward bias, current load, okay. Here if you take for diodes, for example, if you take diode, which I will discuss later, so in diode, forward bias, okay, forward bias, current is allowed, reverse bias, current is not allowed, okay. Like this you can decide the direction, and if you change the voltage, I will apply some voltage between 10 and 15 volt, it should conduct. but less than that it should not conduct, or greater than that it should not conduct. I can impart some conditions. Okay, so here that is why we are writing it as controlled flow. Okay, controlled flow of charge carriers will happen in semiconductors. So when we can decide what is happening, okay, it is a very good thing, because whatever, according to whatever required function, I can do my device control. Okay, so that is why our semiconductors are very helpful in everyday aspect and life. Okay, so now your semiconductors, this is what it does. But you take transistors, logic gates, everything we'll study next. But ultimately what I want you to understand is, okay, for all those things, your semiconductors, this is what is going to happen. Any device that you take, it will either do this operation or this operation. Logically, what will semiconductor device do means, this is only what semiconductor device does. All right. Now, next part, copy it down. Okay. All this is basic information which is required. All right. Next is, if you look at the classification. Okay. Now, on what basis you are dividing this materials as electrical properties we have seen, right? So which will act as insulator, which will act as conductor, which will act as semiconductor means, it is basis of band theory. Okay, what is this I am going to do is, band theory is what I am going to explain. Why band theory? For classification of, okay, many people will not do all the introduction that I does. They'll just simply explain this itself, but here also I'll not waste much of your time. So your band theory for classification of materials, what is this band theory? I'll tell you. Okay, so now what is this bands, on band theory, on what basis you are actually classifying the materials means, okay, now if you take a single atom, okay, so for example, if you take this silicon atom, okay, now if you take this silicon, all right, now for this silicon atom, your silicon is a semiconductor. Silicon and germanium are semiconductors. What are those properties? What is the difference? I'll explain, don't worry. Okay, I'll not waste much of your time. But if you take a silicon atom, now what will silicon atom do is, if you take silicon, the atomic number is 14. All right, so if you write your 14 configuration, okay, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, okay, so first orbital 2 electrons, second orbital 2 electrons, okay, third orbital, I mean 1 2s, in 2p there are 6, so in the third orbital you will have 3s2 and 3p2, like this. This is your electronic configuration. Now, in general, this 14 is 2, 2, 6, 6 plus 4, indirectly 10, stability. So, indirectly, these are in the outer shells. Okay, this is your outer shell. Now, in the outer shell, how many electrons are there in the silicon means? Your silicon is a semiconductor. Okay. So now in the outer shell, how many electrons are there means 4 electrons are there. Okay, so now on band theory, how you are classifying, what is this band theory? I'll come from this part, but just let me give basic information. Now if you take this silicon, okay, now you take any electron out of this silicon atom, okay, I am not looking at crystal. Okay, atom is different, crystal is different. Okay, atom, it is different, crystal is different. Atom and crystal, completely they are different. Okay, now if you take silicon atom, okay, what is that I am taking? I am taking a single silicon atom. Now out of this silicon atom, if I take one electron, if I take this out of this 3s2, one electron, or some 3p2, some electron if I take, now your silicon atom will have discrete energy levels. Okay, in atom what will you have means discrete energy levels. Okay, discrete energy levels will be there. What is this discrete energy levels means? In modern physics, you must have studied. In Bohr's theory, I have explained very clearly. So you will write E equal to minus 13.6 Z square by N square. You will be writing it right. So if you keep N value hydrogen like spectrum, so minus 3.4 if it is hydrogen spectrum, some other value after minus 3.4 by 4 whatever, like this you will have for N equal to 1, N equal to 2, N equal to 3 like this. For every electron in some particular orbit, there is a particular energy. Okay, so there is a fixed sharp energy levels. Okay, so if it is in first state, for example, if it is hydrogen, you light minus 13.6 electron volt. If it is 2, 13.6 by 4, it is minus 3.4. Next level, 13.6 by 9, some 1 point something. My point is, you will have very sharp values. Okay, you will have very sharp values. Okay, you will have very sharp values, which are actually called as discrete energy levels, means, okay, they are separate. Okay, every electron will have its own energy level. Okay, every electron will have its own energy. An electron in first orbit will have its own unique energy. Second orbit, it will have its own unique energy. Third orbit, it will have its own unique energy. So every electron will have a particular position, space, everything. Orbitals you must have studied in chemistry. So my point is, every electron in individual atom will have its own specific energy. So if you take one silicon atom and another silicon atom, okay, so for this if you are marking energy, for this if you are marking energy, there is possibility of both can have same energy. It is allowed, but it has its own value, it has its own value. So discrete energy levels are possible for a single silicon atom. But now if you take silicon crystal, okay, your crystal means what? It will contain lot of atoms. Okay, one mole of crystal, if you take, one mole is what? 6.023 into 10 power 23 grams, 10 power 23. So if you take this, there are lot of atoms. Like 1 gram itself, if you take 1 gram by gram molecular weight into Avogadro number, 6 into 10 power 23. So in 1 gram itself, this many, some n number of atoms are there. That means in the order of around 10 power 23 atoms are there in simple 1 gram itself. So in a crystal of 1 gram, some capital N atoms, which are very big, lot of atoms are there. Now, okay, out of those atoms, instead of taking like this, okay, instead of taking like this, in individual atoms, discrete energy levels I have told you, know. So every electron will have its own sharp boundary and its own specific energy, okay, in the form of straight lines. Okay, so as I have discussed, every electron, if you take, okay, that electron versus 1 by r distance, if you take, you will have its own sharp energy levels. Discrete means they are separate. Okay, now if you take this combination, okay, if you take crystal, inside the crystal there will be lot of atoms. One silicon atom will be there with some equivalent interatomic separation, some R naught. There will be, okay, another silicon atom. Now the silicon atom, I have just simply kept it through balls. But now if you take this silicon atom with electrons like this, okay, one more silicon atom with electrons, some outer orbit electrons, if I take. Now this electron will be attracted by the silicon nucleus, and this electron and this electron, they will repel. So on every electron there is some attraction, repulsion. So every electron will have some its own energies. Okay, if it is having its own position, then obviously it will have its own energy. So my point is, how many electrons are there, that many electrons will have different energies. Okay, different unique energy levels. So for separate discrete energy levels, we have wrote for silicon atom. So in a particular atom, particular electron will have particular energy level. But if you take this as a crystal, out of this combination of n atoms, okay, there is no possibility of discrete energy levels. What you will have is a band of energy levels. Okay, you will have a band, 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 band. this bottom band is actually called as valence band, okay, if this is your axis, and somewhere here you will have your conduction band. This band is called valence band, this is called as conduction band, this is called as energy gap. I will tell you, but for crystal, if for electrons inside the crystal, okay, like this, there are different electrons. Individual silicon atoms, if you take, sharp energy levels, -13.6 into z square by 1 square, z square by 2 square, z square by 3 square, individual atoms, silicon atoms if you take. But if you combine or if you look at the crystal, in crystal there is no sharp lines or no possibility of discrete energy levels. You will have bands. How did these bands come? I will tell you, don't worry. What is this valence band? What is this conduction band? I will elaborate much more, don't worry. But my point is, in combinations, okay, for every electron, okay, if there are like n atoms inside silicon crystal, almost you have, for every, if you look at, there are 4 outer shell electrons. So 4n electrons are there almost. So all those 4n electrons, for n atoms, 4n electrons are there. 4n electrons will have their own unique energy levels. Okay, every electron is having a particular velocity, particular position. Okay, so they will not collide. If they are colliding, what will happen? That crystal will automatically split into parts. Unlike, I mean, in nuclear radiation, that is what you have studied, right? So to attain stability, disintegration will happen. Now, no such thing will happen in crystals. If the crystal is stable, okay, obviously electrons are there, they are not colliding. So every electron will have their own unique position inside the crystal. So every electron will have unique energy level. So that unique energy levels will belong to these bands, okay. In crystals, no possibility of unique energy levels. You will have bands, which is called as valence band and conduction band, okay. And there is some gap called as forbidden energy gap. What is this? I will elaborate, okay. But hope you are getting my point. If you look at the energies of electrons inside the crystal, okay, so that electrons, they'll in individual atoms, they'll have discrete energy levels, but in crystals, there will be bands, okay. How did these bands come? Why these bands are coming? I'll elaborate, okay. So now let me erase this, okay. So now let me erase this. So what is exactly this band theory? Hope you have understood briefly. I will elaborate, okay. For silicon crystal, how these bands are coming, I will tell you, okay. So individual atom, discrete energy levels, each electron will have its own unique value. If you take one atom separately, same graph can come. But within a crystal, if you take, lot of electrons are there, each electron will have its own position, so that electron will have its own energy level. So what is this bands will come? I'll come from that part, okay. Hope you have copied it down. If not, pause the video clip and copy it down now, okay. So what is this band theory? I have just briefly explained it here. Now let me put it in logical aspect, okay. Mostly people will give you that graph directly, but based on this band theory, we'll classify it. So that valence band, conduction band, how it is coming? First I'll put it logically. Then in semiconductors, how is that? In insulators, how is it? In conductors, how is it? What is the overlapping? What is this energy gap? Everything I'll show it to you. Then you'll get very good clarity. So now first, let us take a simple silicon crystal. Okay. Now this silicon crystal, atomic number is what? 14. So for 14, what will you write? 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. Okay. And it is 3s2. 3p2, right? So atomic number 14 means this is what is going to happen. So this is indirectly inner shell, this is your outer shell, okay. Now your s orbital, okay, chemistry orbital theory, so your p orbital will be into 3 categories, okay, px, py, pz, and d, it is phi, you know that, okay. So now this is your s orbital, which one? 3s, okay, and this is what? 3p. So you have 2 electrons in a single shell like this, and here you have your unpaired electron, right? So if you write the electronic configuration of this outer shell, before that you will put it, but we don't need this. This is your inner shell. Let's look at the outer shell alone. So now if you look at this outer shell, okay, let us consider one silicon atom. Okay, so look at this one single atom. If you take, and for crystal if you take, okay, for you to have clarity, I am telling you, okay. So one silicon atom will consist of, okay, right, how many electrons in outer shell means your number of electrons is, okay, one silicon atom, how many electrons are there in outer shell? 4 electrons. Now in a crystal, let us say there are totally capital N number of atoms, okay, capital N atoms, okay, where capital N is what? If it is 1 mole itself, if you take, it is 6.023 × 10^23. So if you take 1 gram also, it will be close to the order of 10^23. So now how many electrons are there? Your N is in the order of 6.023. indirectly your N is close to 10^22 to 10^23, very big number, okay. If you take a crystal, 1 gram crystal itself, if you are taking, that much big number it is. So now in this, how many number of electrons are there means your number of outer shell electrons, okay, number of outer shell electrons are 4n, okay. Now what if you look at this, these 4 electrons are filled into which orbital? 3s orbital, 3p, px orbital and py orbital, okay. They are filled into px and py, all right. So 4 electrons are present, 4 electrons, 4n electrons are present in the crystal, 4 electrons are present in atom, okay. Number of electrons in silicon atom is this much. Now if you look at the energy levels, okay, if you give energy, what will happen? Degeneration of orbitals will happen. You must have studied in chemistry, overlapping of orbitals, okay. Overlapping of orbitals will happen to form the bonds. That is what you have studied in chemistry. If you remember, you have studied covalent bond, ionic bond, that bond, this bond, metallic bond, those bonds you have studied, right? So if you have remembered that, okay, if you give energy to this electron, okay, this electron can jump into one of the orbitals. So now if you look at this possibility of state, okay, possibility of state, your electron in px, if you give energy, it can jump into pz. That is a possibility, all right. So that means what is happening, your electron, it will absorb energy and it will excite and go to higher states, which is pretty common and obvious thing. Now if you look at this, okay, if you look at these shells, okay, now a single atom, okay, number of possible energy levels, okay, number of possible energy levels, okay, possible energy levels will be, here there are 2 electrons. So in S position S itself, in 3S there are 2 electrons. So 2 energy levels discretely they are possible, okay, it can accommodate 2 electrons. So 2 energy levels are possible, okay. So here 2, then px 2 energy levels, py 2 energy levels and pz 2 energy levels. There are energy levels, okay, but we are giving configuration for stability as this configuration. But if you give energy, this electron could jump, all right. So that means totally here 2 2 2 6 6 plus 2, totally 8. So number of possible energy levels in a single atom is itself 8. So here, okay, number of possible energy levels, okay, will almost be 8n here, okay. So there are totally 8n possible energy levels, but out of those 8n, how many are filled? Only 4n are filled, okay. Out of 8n, filled ones are 4n in crystal, okay. and only 4 are filled in atom. Okay, possible energy levels, each electron will have its own unique position, right? My point, hope you are getting, its own position, angular momentum, everything. In chemistry you must have studied these things. So my point is, each electron will have its own unique position. So now it is taking a fixed values. Okay, now these 4 electrons will have these filled states. But possible how many, if you give energy, probably through light, thermionic emission, field effect, something, you give external electric field, you can do some stuff. So if you do some kind of operation, these electrons, these 4 electrons can, take different positions. Their possible energy levels will be 8 here and 8 and here. In crystal, 8 and positions are there. Now, if you take for atom, okay, all these electrons, these 8 possible energy levels, they are sharp, they are discrete. Okay, so 8 electrons, 8 energy levels are possible. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 like this. Okay, as you actually keep going up, energy gap will decrease. So if you give electron here, it will jump into this. More here, it is sharp. For atom, it is sharp. For atom, it will be sharp, discrete energy levels. But if you take the crystal, okay, your 1 electron volt gap, if you take, for example, if this gap is close to some 1 electron volt or somewhere here, some 1 electron volt gap is there. Okay, here some 13 and 3 means around 10 electron volt is there. As you keep going up, this gap decreases. So somewhere here 1 electron volt gap is there. Now within this 1 electron volt, okay, for individual atom, sharpness is there. Okay, they are discrete like this. But if you take the crystal part, okay, within that 1 electron volt, okay, 1 electron volt is getting divided for 8 and possible levels. Here, if it is a single atom, 1 electron volt energy is getting divided only for 8 levels, or everything is discrete here. But out of 4 n crystals, this 1 electron volt gap will happen. It will be every electron, they will not overlap. They will have almost close, but they will have their own energy levels. But my point is, if you take for the crystal, okay, if you take for the crystal, okay, there is no sharp energy levels. Okay, what will happen is, within the crystal, if you take for this crystal, okay, this energy gap, if you are dividing for n electrons, okay, so 10 power 23 means it will get divided for almost 10 power 23 atoms, 10 power 23 atoms, each atom will contribute 1 electron. So every electron will have, okay, 1 electron, 1 electron, 1 electron, like this. Your 4 n electrons will actually divide in this, okay, 1 electron volt energy gap. Like this, 10 power 23 electrons will be there. 10 power 23 atoms are there. In 10 power 23, each single atom 4 electrons. So 4n into 10 power 23, total number of electrons are there. 4n into 10 power 23 electrons will distribute this energy. So my point here is, in a crystal, okay, you cannot have discrete energy levels. Because there are more number of atoms, okay, because there are more number of atoms, what will happen is, you are 4n into almost 10 power 23 electron, 10 power 23 electrons are there. This, suppose for example, if px of individual atom is somewhere here in 1 electron volt region, okay, with gap like this. Now 4n into 10 power 23 electrons must share this gap, okay, they should not overlap, but they will have discrete levels like this. Imagine how much small it is. So that is why this entire region in a crystal, we are calling it as a band. Okay, hope you have understood this. So now, how many possible energy levels are there means, okay, totally 8n are there, but out of it 4n are filled. This filled one is called as valence band, and empty one, okay, remaining out of 8n, 4n are filled, 4n are empty. This 4n empty one are called conduction band. Okay, this energy levels are only called as bands. This filled ones is called as valence band. Empty one is actually called as conduction band. Okay, so now single discrete energy level, what is happening for different n electrons? It is getting divided like this. Okay, here for example, if you take 3p xor py electron, if you take px here, py here, your 3py energy level, okay, there are totally how many? 8n, that means, okay, totally 8n are there. So 8n into 10 power 23, your 3s orbital will be somewhere here. Okay, so like this, then 3s will split further into, there are, because n electrons are there, n into 10 power 23. So n is close to 10 power 23, so 8 into 10 power 23 levels here, 8 into 10 power 23 levels here, 8 into 10 power 23 levels. Each atom, if you take, it will contribute 1 electron in 3s, here 2 electrons. So somewhere here, what will happen? This px and s orbital will overlap, py and px will overlap. So this overlapping will happen, okay, which you are calling it as chemistry bonds or degeneration of orbitals. Okay, so if this overlapping is happening, obviously you will have a region. So scientists have explained that, okay, scientists have explained that, okay, if you take your graph of energy of crystal versus atomic distance 1 by r graph like this, then if you try to take this, okay, your 3p will have some energy gap like this, your 3s state also will have 2 electrons, it will split into 2, px and py also will have 2 things. So there is some overlapping like this, there is a graph like this with different energy levels, okay. So you will have some kind of graph like this, where in which this region, okay, where in which electrons are present, okay, in 3p orbital pz is empty, so pz will be in the higher state, okay. So this region is called as conduction band, this region is called as valence band, in between it is your forbidden region. What is this forbidden region? I will tell you. But if you look at these bands, this is from where the band theory will come. Okay, now most of the people will not give good explanation to this, but still I have tried my best, and if you have any doubts you can ask me. So my point is, if you are trying to take the energies and try to draw a graph for crystals, okay, this graph is for crystal. So for a crystal you will have this kind of bands, okay. So you will have valence band, you will have conduction band. Valence band mostly filled, conduction band it is empty or partially filled, okay. So I'll give definitions, okay, don't worry. So here my point is, your valence band, okay, completely filled, okay, right. VB is valence band, CB is conduction band, empty or partially filled, okay, it is empty or partially filled, your conduction band is empty or partially filled, okay, right. So this is what I want you to understand, okay. Now based on these bands, okay, our material will be classified into semiconductors, insulators and, okay, semiconductors, insulators and conductors. Okay, metals or conductors, both words will actually mean the same. Okay, copy it down, I'll show the difference. So I am erasing it. So now what will happen is, if you try to classify these materials, okay, I am not talking of atoms, okay, although we are using the idea of atom to explain, okay, your materials, if you take, okay, if you take metals or conductors, both mean the same, okay, and this side if I take semiconductors and this side I will take insulators. Okay, this is the area from where questions will actually come. So now according to band theory, what will happen is, all right, your conduction band, okay, your conduction band is this, okay, your valence band will be here, okay. So your, what will happen, I will tell you, okay. So your valence band and conduction band will overlap, okay. So I'll write that very clearly, okay. I forgot another thing, your conduction band bottom I'll keep it as EC, valence band top I'll keep it as EB, okay. This is energy level of top of valence band, this is energy level of top of conduction band, okay. Write it to this side, this energy gap, okay, this is called as energy gap, okay. EG is energy gap, your energy gap is this, I have forgot, so that is why I am explaining, your energy gap is, okay, top of conduction band minus top of, sorry, bottom of conduction band minus top of valence band, okay. This is not top of conduction band, sorry, bottom, okay, bottom of conduction band minus top of valence band, okay. So EV, so your energy gap is this, okay. So clearly I will write, so in metals or conductors, okay, overlapping of, okay, valence band and conduction band takes place, okay. Overlapping of valence band and conduction band will take place in metals or semiconductors, sorry, metals or conductors. If you take these semiconductors, okay, in semiconductors what will happen is, there is a small energy gap, okay. So this is your valence band, this is your conduction band, okay. This energy gap is small, small gap, no overlapping, but you give energy, electrons can easily jump, okay. No overlapping, okay, slight energy, okay, electron jumps from valence band to conduction band, okay. Here by default valence band is filled, okay, conduction band is, okay, partially filled, okay, you can assume it to be partially filled indirectly, okay. So your electrons, your conductivity is because of electrons in the conduction band, or if you give slight electric field, okay, it could be empty or partially filled, but you give slight value, that is enough, but here you have to give little more, that's all, okay. So you give slightly more values, that is enough, okay. So here your energy gap, okay, your energy gap is close to 0 electron volt or hardly less than, in some books it will be less than 1 electron volt is the energy gap. Here your energy gap is less than 3 electron volt, okay, your energy gap is less than 3 electron volt. For silicon, okay, your energy gap is 1.4 electron volt, for germanium it is 0.7 electron volt, okay, right. For silicon it is close to 1.1, in some books it is 1.4, okay. So I'll write 1.1 and 0.7, okay, right. Next, if you take this insulators, in the insulators part, okay, hope you have copied this to the side, I'll erase this, okay, I need this information. So briefly I have explained that energy gap. Next is, if you take, okay, all this is basic information, okay, So this part is your conduction band, and your valence band is here. Conduction band is on the top. Okay. So this gap is very big. Gap is very big. Okay. This gap is very big. Okay. No overlapping. Gap is very big. High energy is required. Okay. High energy is required for jumping of electrons from BB to conduction band. Your energy gap is greater than 6 electron volt or close to 6 electron volt. Okay. For diamond, it is 6 electron volt, I suppose, if I remember. Look at the books. Okay. And another important point is, at 0 Kelvin, okay, at 0 Kelvin, okay, semiconductor acts as insulator. Semiconductor acts as insulator. Why? Because, okay, your kinetic energy of molecule, you will write 3 by 2 times Boltzmann constant into temperature, right? So if T is 0, energy is 0. If energy is 0, no velocity, no current, nothing. Okay, no current, no conduction. So if there is no conduction, obviously no velocity, no current, no drift velocity, no current, no conduction, obviously. Okay, so that is why at 0 Kelvin, semiconductor will act as insulator. Okay, this bit in lot of regional entrance exam they have asked, and many people will take wrong answers. I cannot do anything. Right, next. Next is valence band completely filled, conduction band empty. I'll continue this table, copy it. Okay, in the book, pause the video clip, copy all these points. Okay, resistivity value, type of bonding I need to do. So I'll erase this, I'll continue further. Copy it down, this difference table is important. I will write little extra points in this table, okay, not to miss. I will just have a look at the book. Lot of this is a very big subject, entire electronics and communication engineering. For 4 years you will study, okay, around 40 subjects you will study within this itself, but we will do a small part. So how much is required, I will just look into the book and give the important points. So I will write the points. They have free electron density of around 10 power 28 per meter cube. Okay, here your free electron density is 10 power 28 per meter cube is your free electron density in metals. Okay, in insulators, no free electrons. Okay, no free electrons, very high free electron density in metals. And in semiconductors, okay, empty conduction band and full valence band. So here I will write electrons and holes depending upon the situation. Okay, so electrons and holes are there, but here my point is, don't worry, here I cannot give density, it depends upon the semiconductor. Fully filled valence band and empty conduction band. Okay, I don't know whether I have written this point previously or not, I don't remember. If not, what is there? Once again, if you write, also no issues. And here insulators completely filled VB, completely filled valence band, and empty conduction band, they're overlapping. Okay, so overlapping means you have partially filled this thing on the top of valence band, partially filling is there. Okay, right. Next, resistivity is in the order of, okay, resistivity is 10 power minus 8 ohm meter. Okay, you just remember this information. Okay, I'll just have a look into the book rather than turning my head this many times. Standard information, I'll just write it here. You just copy it down and mug it up. Okay, resistivity is in order of 10 power minus 8. Okay, range is there, in some books it will be different. Okay, metallic bond here, type of bonding is metallic bond. Okay, next, resistivity increases with increase in temperature. Resistivity increases with increase in temperature. Okay, resistivity increases with increase in temperature. Okay, right, temperature coefficient is positive, in the bracket temperature coefficient is positive. Okay, this information you must remember. Okay, next, for insulators large gap, resistivity is 10 power 12 to 10 power 20, okay, ohm meter. Now, conductivity is what? Reciprocal. Sigma is 1 by rho. Conductivity is reciprocal. Okay, so you can decide it. For which elements resistivity is more, obviously conductivity will be less. Okay, next, covalent and ionic. Here the bond is covalent and ionic. Okay, next, temperature coefficient is negative because of which resistivity decreases with increase in temperature. Resistivity decreases with increase in temperature. Okay, all these are basic points, please do copy it down. If you have any doubts, just let me know. Okay, next, here resistivity is in the order of 10 power minus 5 minus 8 to 10 power minus 5 ohm meter. 10 power minus 8 to 10 power minus 5. Okay, and conductivity reciprocal, bonding is covalent bond. Okay, type of bonding is covalent bond. Okay, you just copy all this information. Okay, basic information, right? 0 Kelvin insulator, that also I have explained. Okay, next, temperature coefficient is negative and large. Okay, here it is negative and small. Here temperature coefficient is negative and large for semiconductors. Okay, because of which what will happen? Okay, rise of temperature, resistivity decreases. Increasing temperature decreases resistivity, resistance indirectly. Okay, so slight increase in temperature, it will become a very good conductor. All right, so yeah, this is enough. All right, and your Fermi energy level is there. Your Fermi energy level is your valence band plus conduction band by 2. Okay, this is your Fermi energy level, EFI, right? Okay, this is Fermi energy level. Okay, next I will talk of intrinsic and extrinsic conductors. During that time I will tell you. Okay, so what is this Fermi energy level means? Your gap of conduction band, if you take, this is EC, valence band if you take EV, exactly in the middle, this gap by 2. Okay, so that is why EV plus EC by 2. Here you will have your Fermi energy level. Okay, Fermi energy level. Difference is gap, Fermi energy level is average. Okay, right. So with this information, in the next lecture, I will continue into intrinsic and extrinsic conductors. Okay, so all this information, whatever I have written on the board, you just mug it up. Basic questions they will ask. 0 degree Kelvin, semiconductor will act as insulator. If you increase the temperature, resistivity decreases. Okay, decreases resistance. So that means obviously conductivity increases. I have written resistivity property willingly. Okay, if you remember resistivity, conductivity is reciprocal. Okay, so first column conductor, second column semiconductors, third column insulators. Okay, with this we'll stop. In the next lecture we'll discuss in detail about your intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductors. That's all for today. Thank you.